I'm Katie Darrell, and today we are at home and social with Nancy Wilson. Hello, welcome. I mean, what a pleasure. I have to tell you, we've been doing these at home and social interviews since we all got locked down, and I am so stoked to talk to you. And we've talked to everyone here from Alice Cooper to Dee Snider and Sebastian Bach and like all everyone. Oh, wow. You, I mean,
all my pals.
Today is my day. I am just a lover of your music. I'm just going to geek out the entire time, but I'm going to try and rein it in. I owe you a giant congratulations because this week you are going to be honored at the 9th annual She Rocks Awards. And that's a big deal. There's a lot of great names being honored alongside you.
Yeah, no, I know. We kind of pre-recorded some of that the other day, and they sent me the award in the mail. So I was able to do the acceptance speech thing, and they're cutting it all together, I guess, today, and it's coming right up on the 22nd.
That is fantastic. And like I mentioned, there's other women that are being honored. And I would love to get your personal industry take on some of these other awesome females, like Amy Lee of Evanescence. What a monster, what a force, right?
Yeah, no, I know. It's really cool to see women, appreciating other women in the business and, the creatives, there's a lot of creativity with women. And it's something I normally don't go for is like the gender specific thing of it all, like, single women out from just the broader categories of want. But in this case, I think it's really a cool thing because it's, it's an unusual thing for women to be way up front and be the big rock stars and leaders and, front of the cart.
Well, but you led the pack. Listen, I mean, for every glass ceiling that there was for females who wanted to rock out and rock hard, like you busted the ceiling for everyone. And I'm sure you get told this probably every time you meet a fellow female musician, right?
Yeah, that's really true. I mean, I think we were pretty dogged going into the job, and being military brats, Marine Corps brats, didn't hurt either. And so we were pretty brave and ready to just be the Beatles and not try to marry the Beatles, be the force, and lead the force, lead the charge. And so I guess, yes, all those elements kind of stacked up in our favor. And we were not shy about it.
And at the end of the day, you were talented. You had what it took, right? I mean, you can shred.
We started very young, because I was like 8 when I started playing guitar, saw the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan Show. Mm-hmm. And then I was just hell bent from that moment forward to be a competent guitar player and songwriter and singer and whatever. Anything about rock, I wanted to do it. So I got my wish.
Having started at the age of 8, right? And I know a lot of people will say they still haven't mastered their craft. That aside, at what age do you feel like you really got good at it? Where you're like, I've got a handle of this. I can hold my own and I can rock. I can do this. I play guitar, period.
Right. I was obsessed with learning how to play guitar, and I learned really fast. I mean, I just absorbed the guitar, with every molecule I could put into it. And my DNA is guitar, so I was born to play. And like Anne was kind of born to sing, she's got that extra gift that just works for her as a singer. I have got that as a player, I guess. And it's my best friend,
Right. Do you have favorite guitars that are like, that it has to be the one that you hold when you are trying to create new music? Obviously, there's certain songs that you've written in the past, but when you're trying to get inspired to create new.
Yeah, I mean, I have my friends, you know, my best friend guitars around. There's a Martin, signature Martin that I designed with the Martin Company. That's a real favorite for stage or for writing or just sitting around playing, you know, just learning, creating for acoustic. And then my old blue Telecaster that I've had for eons, you know, it's like a 62 or three.
Wow.
Blue Telecaster, you know, Lake Placid blue Tele. That's my go-to main man electrically. So, you know, those are my favorite boyfriends.
I love it. You have a new album that you're going to be putting out April 2020. It's called You and Me, and there's a title track called You and Me as well, right?
Exactly. Yep. It's almost finished. It'll take a while for it to, you know, be readily available, but it should be fine for all done. We'll have another single coming out, which is the title track, probably next month. And then the rest of it will all come out in April. And it's just really exciting and rewarding for me to be doing this. I mean, because of the shutdown too, it's like never in my life have I really been sort of forced to stay home and off of the road, not touring all the time or trying to record with a Heart album, you know, over there between tours. So it's been really rewarding and really fulfilling to kind of reconnect with my college girl self, you know, who was taking the creative writing and learning how to play mandolin and just trying to get good, you know, and be creative and write a song. So, yeah, so it's really a blessing inside of a larger curse, obviously, but we moved up to Northern California recently, and there's a gorgeous music space here for me, which I've never really had, believe it or not. I never really had a home studio to speak of. And I was always, you know, like afraid of making too much noise in the house. Somebody's trying to sleep or, you know, trying to rock out in the house. So now I've got a separate place to go where I can just be as loud as I like.
When you were writing and working on this album, did you find your melody and the music first, or are you someone that was keeping a journal of lyrics and you were inspired by those?
I come at it every which way. I have journals with title ideas and lyric ideas, and then I have little memos on the phone of melody ideas.
Yeah.
And, or a little riff here or a little piano part there, you know, so eventually things kind of come together and get finished. There's still a lot of things just laying around that are not finished yet, but, you know, but it's all, you know, it all feeds into one bigger picture, which is, you know, now a solo album, my first ever recorded.
I was shocked. It's your first solo album, which is, I'm shocked too.
I'm like,
what were you waiting for, man?
I think I was stuck in traffic or something. I don't know. I was in the vortex, you know, the Heart vortex for so long.
What I love about the album is there's some really cool collaborations on there. You've got Sammy Hagar, who love Sammy Hagar at Access TV.
Oh God, yeah.
Taylor Hawkins of the Foo Fighters plays on the album as well, right?
Yeah, I sang some stuff on his solo album called Get the Money, which is a great album. And so I said, when I was trying to start this album, I said, do you have anything laying around? You know,
any odds and ends?
Odds and ends laying around. And he did. Him and Duff McKagan had this great little jam that I said, I'll take that, I'll finish it. And then after it was kind of done, I sent it back to Taylor and he sang a whole bunch of cool harmony stuff for me. So it's a fun song. It's called Party at the Angel Ballroom.
And then with the passing of Eddie Van Halen this in 2020, damn you, 2020, right?
No,
there's an instrumental tribute to Eddie Van Halen, correct?
There is. It's called For Edward, and it's a minute and a half instrumental acoustic piece for him, you know, tribute to him, because I was the first, when we were touring in the 80s, he was like, you're really good on that acoustic guitar. You're a really good guitar player on acoustic. And I said, well, why don't you ever play on acoustic? And he said, well, I don't really have an acoustic. I was like, what? You don't have an acoustic? So I said, well, you do now, because I gave him one. And
wow.
So, yeah. So then, like, flash to crack of dawn later that morning, that night, yeah, after that night, he calls up in my phone in the hotel room, which before, you know, cell phones.
Press 7 and then the room number. And
Yeah. But there was like room, you know, everybody had each other's room numbers, but which was a dangerous, you know, thing. he called me and he said, oh my God, I've got this thing I wrote on this acoustic. He was up all night, obviously. And he played it for me over the phone, and it was really gorgeous. And I'm hoping, you know, like hell that somewhere it's recorded, because it was one of the prettiest things I might have ever heard on a guitar. And so I thought really hard about, you know, how to tribute him with a piece that my vague memory of what he played for me might have been sort of like that. So I made it kind of almost classical to start, and then it had to rock in the middle, and then kind of another classical bookends of an ending with a little interesting button at the end of that. So I'm very happy with it.
I'm sure you just have story after story of being out on the road with fellow musicians that are all, you know, mega superstars like yourself. Which tours stick out in your mind, and which bands were the easiest to tour with? The follow-up question, which ones were the most fun to tour with, which may not have been easy?
I think many times we've been out with Cheap Trick, and they're just the greatest people you'd ever want to know. And they're the sweetest, funniest, smartest rock guys you could ever hang out with. And, you know, the last time we were out and they were on the tour with us, I came out during one of the big ballads that they did, where Rick Nielsen's out there on his little, he's got a tiny little stage that he stands on top of with a board on it, you know, and stuff like that. And he throws picks out, and Robin Zander gets down on his knees at one point, you know, on this one big ballad that they do. And I came up from behind him and I put the cape on his shoulders during his big, you know, his big moment on stage, you know, he's kneeling on his knees. So, and he didn't know it was me. And so I kissed him on the cheek and he was like, what?
Yeah. Right. So,
yeah. So we always, you know, had shenanigans with those guys. Really fun.
That is so great. Well, here on the show, we do a segment. It's called Rock and Tell. Rock and Tell is like show and tell, kindergartner style, but with much radder stuff.
Oh my God.
I've
got some really good stuff right here. In our family home, when we were trying to be the Beatles, we made fakey guitars in our dad's workshop. Now this is made out of cardboard and fishing line.
Wow.
And paint and glue. These are like knobs that turn, you know. And this is the John Lennon Rickenbacker. Of course, it's kind of fallen apart. And that was the one Anne built. And the one that I built was the George Harrison Country Gentleman Gretsch. Wow. So there's like there's a knob here. And there's a switch right there. Aren't those awesome?
That is so great. I mean, yeah, I remember reading that, like how inspired you were to obviously watch the Beatles on the Ed Sullivan show. And seriously. You meant it.
Yeah. And these are like light switch covers or something, or that is. Like,
I mean, how old were you when you and your sister were building these?
Must have been like 10, maybe 10 or 9 or 10, I guess.
That's amazing.
But that's pretty good show and tell.
That's a very good one. Anything else you can share with us?
Well, I've got my same as a little baby. I got this toy. His name is Mogan. And he has my name stitched in his ear in case he got lost.
Oh, my goodness. So
and my mom had made some extra eyes for him because he lost his eyes. He used to be blue.
Ah!
But he's, that's Mogan, my dog, my first dog. And here's when he's scared. And here's when he's mad. And here's when he's kind of confused.
I love it. Does this go out on the road with you?
I've taken him. Yeah, I've taken him. He'll sleep in my bunk with me in the bus.
I love it. I love it. And, yeah. And what about that blue Strat that you were talking about? Does that happen to be at an arm's reach?
Oh, it's not. It's the Telecaster, it's next door. But you'll see it in many, many, many images since, you know, probably the early 80s when I got it. Yeah.
What song gets you excited to play still? Because I know, I mean, listen, they're all great songs. We love hearing them, but you've played them a million times each. Which one do you still get psyched to play?
Oh, many of them. I think there's a lot of great heart songs that are still really fun to play. Even Barracuda, you know, Crazy on You with the acoustic intro. You know, Straight On is a good one. It's really funky. And it's a good dance thing to dance to. And stuff like Mistral Wind is a lot more challenging, but more kind of, you know, epic. And it takes up a lot of space, songs like Mistral.
And what songs do you like to warm up to when you're sound checking and warming up? Do you do heart songs or do you like to pull out other ditties?
We pull out all kinds of ditties when we're sound checking because it's fun, you know, it's off the beaten path. Yeah. And so we do, you know, we'll do like Tom Petty songs or we'll do Beatles songs or, you know, we could do almost any kind of song that's been on the radio that we grew up with, you know, kind of stuff. So that's always really fun to do. I mean, I'm entertaining an idea to do a whole album of Tom Petty songs because of all those amazing songs and to reinterpret, you know, as a female vocalist too, would be really an interesting spin on that. But I don't know, I might do it.
Have you ever heard another band cover your stuff and been impressed, like a male voice doing the hard stuff?
Well, I don't think that's very easy to pull off because the key, for one thing, it's going to be so high. But there's a lot of guys in rock that sing very, very high. I just don't think anybody's really done it.
I think we got to put the challenge out there.
Yeah, maybe we should have a contest.
You know, I think we need to rearrange it, drop the key a little bit, and I'd love to hear baritone doing it.
That would be really interesting, you know, because, I mean, when you change the gender around, it can really change the meaning. And, like, when we first did that one huge hit that we had way back when called All I Want to Do Is Make Love to You. It was written by Mutt Lang, right? So when we sang it, we changed the gender around. And that's why it got banned in Ireland. Because
it's
a wanted woman who picks up a stray man in her car and then uses him for, you know, sex or whatever, has his child out of wedlock.
Woo!
We got, yeah, banned in Ireland, which was kind of, we felt really cool about that.
I'm sure. That is awesome. Well, I mean, listen, you've accomplished a lot, you know, getting inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But you know what? Getting banned in Ireland's pretty rad.
That's really good. You know, really. I mean, that's how rock can you get? That's pretty rock.
You know, wrapping it all back up to where we started, you are going to be honored this week at the 9th annual She Rocks Awards. That's a great honor. That's another trophy for the shelf. What trophies do you keep on display? Because I know at this point you've got so many awards that they're probably in cardboard boxes.
A whole new wing onto the house. You know,
I know, right?
All these awards. No, I love the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame Award. I love having that next to my grandma's piano you see behind me probably there. And, you know, there's an ASCAP award that's really pretty. Now the She Rocks Award, it's kind of matches the ASCAP award. And it's just nice to be acknowledged, because I never was out for the awards of it all, but I was always out for the respect of having done a good job, you know, like having been a competent musician who was acknowledged for the work. And I think there's nothing wrong with getting some awards for that. Nothing wrong with that at all for me.
It always feels nice to be told, good job.
Yeah.
Pat on the back.
Good job. Good job. You finished the interview today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure chatting with you. Truly love your music, and thank you for giving Access TV some time.
Oh, not a problem. Anytime.